Look at these tiny particles drifting randomly through space, bouncing and spreading in every direction. While this process appears chaotic, we actually know the physical equations governing the movement of these particles. And even more surprisingly, the same equations are at the heart of the revolution behind much of today's generative AI. So let's see how we can use physics to reverse this chaos and generate brand new data in the process. Before we go further, you might be wondering why I make a second video on diffusion models, while we already covered them in the last video. Well, the reason is that diffusion models actually have two very different formulations. The first one, the one we covered last time, was popularized by Jonathan Ho in 2020, based on a previous work published in 2015. It is mostly based on variational inference, so the general derivations and framework are close to variational autoencoders. We defined a forward noising process using a Markov chain and learned to reverse it by training a neural network with the evidence lower bound. But a little earlier, in 2019, another line of work was being developed by Yang Song, following ideas from energy-based models and score matching. This formulation is based on a completely different mathematical framework, but also provided very good generation results at the time. Yang Song then introduced a fundamentally different perspective in 2021, which we usually call score-based diffusion models. Personally, I prefer this second formulation. However, keep in mind that both points of view describe the very same objects, and both of them are equally valid. So, let's see what the score-based formulation is all about. In DDPM, we defined a discrete Markov chain to corrupt data step-by-step with Gaussian noise. The specific expression of this Markov chain was carefully chosen so that it converges to a normal distribution when we apply it a lot of time. And sure enough, with this expression, when t becomes very big, we end up with something looking very close to pure Gaussian noise. The time-dependent beta parameter controls how big each step is, meaning how much noise we add to the image. If we take big steps between each image, the neural network struggles to reverse this noising process. And if we take very small steps, we have to do a lot more iterations to reach pure Gaussian noise. Now, instead of thinking in terms of discrete steps, we'll take a whole other point of view. Let's think of this process in terms of very, very small noising steps. Now, at the infinitesimal scale, this is the expression describing our noising process. Okay, it looks kind of scary, but trust me, it is actually pretty intuitive. This is a specific kind of stochastic differential equation called an Itô equation. What does that even mean? Well, it's called a differential equation because it relates the variable x to its infinitesimal change over time. And it is stochastic because this expression contains a second term called a Brownian process, which is random. Let's think of this in terms of particles. The first term in the equation describes how the position of a particle changes due to a deterministic force, like a wind pushing it in a given direction. This term is called the drift, and it is completely deterministic, meaning that we can predict the exact path that the particle will follow. Now, as I said, the second term is random, and it is comprised of a Brownian process as well as a diffusion coefficient. These two terms capture all the tiny unpredictable fluctuations in the environment, making the particle appear to move randomly. The diffusion coefficient is the function controlling the intensity of this random motion. If it is small, the particle barely moves, and if it is big, the particle makes big random jumps. When we combine these two terms, the resulting motion is neither fully deterministic nor entirely random. The particles generally follow the direction imposed by the deterministic force, but their paths remain influenced by random fluctuations. Let's now see which specific drift and diffusion coefficients correspond to the DDPM Markov chain. So let's first recall the expression of this Markov chain describing the noising process in the DDPM framework. We'll quickly demonstrate how this chain actually converges to the Itô equation we just saw, which will also reveal the drift and diffusion coefficients. The first step is to define a new quantity, which we'll call beta tilde. It's simply the number of steps, big N, multiplied by the noise variance, beta. By plugging this into the original equation, we get a slightly different but equivalent formulation. Now let's introduce a small time interval, delta t, which we'll eventually let shrink to zero. We can just take 1 over big N the number of steps, so as N increases, delta T becomes smaller and smaller. Next, we reinterpret the index I in terms of continuous time. We'll say that X at discrete step I is simply the image at time T plus delta T, and beta tilde at step I becomes beta evaluated at time T plus delta T. If we replace this in our previous expression, we get this formulation which only depends on TT and delta T. Now, once we have this equation, the trick is to take the first order Taylor expansion of the left-hand term, which is possible because we make delta T tend to zero. This lets us rewrite X at time T plus delta T as approximately equal to this new expression. Now we make a second approximation. We assume that beta at time T plus delta T is very close to beta at time T, which again is valid when delta T is small. With that, we can write that the difference between X at time T plus delta T and X at time T is approximately equal to this quantity. And since delta T goes to zero, on the left we're really looking at the infinitesimal change in X. That's it. We're almost there. This is now a differential equation. Now this second term on the right happens to be the exact expression of the random Brownian process we saw earlier, the one responsible for those tiny random jumps in particles. And just like that, we arrived at our Itô equation. Well, that was a lot. How about we take a quick break from all the equations and dive into something a little more relaxing? Thanks to Skillshare for sponsoring this video. If you're curious like me but need to recharge with something creative, Skillshare's got you covered. It's an online learning platform with thousands of classes in creative skills like knitting, sewing, illustration, or even photography. Whether you want to pick up a hands-on hobby, explore digital art, or learn how to take better photos with your phone, there's something for every kind of curiosity. One class I really liked is about transforming secondhand furniture with simple tools and a bit of vision. Super satisfying, and no prior experience needed. But you can also find classes on creative writing, cooking, journaling, or productivity, if you're the kind of person who likes to learn across the board. The first 500 people to use my link in the description will receive 20% off their first year of Skillshare. If you want to try it out first, Skillshare has a 7-day free trial. Get started today. And we're back to our Itô equation. The drift term on the left is minus 1/2 times beta of t, our variance schedule, times x, our image or particle. And the diffusion coefficient is the square root of beta of t, which makes sense because it's just the standard deviation of the noise we chose to add at each step in DDPM. So now we know the drift and diffusion coefficients, but what's the actual effect of this equation on a given distribution of particles? If we take the example of this distribution, you can see that as time progresses, the points get shuffled around, but they remain roughly centered around zero. This is because the drift term pulls them toward the origin, while the diffusion term spreads them out, preventing them from collapsing to a single point. In fact, over time, this stochastic differential equation transforms any initial distribution into a Gaussian. This is just another way of looking at what happens in the forward process of DDPM, where we gradually turn images into pure noise. Here, we gradually transform any distribution into a Gaussian. But how does this relate to image generation? Well, imagine that each point here represents an image. After all, images are just vectors in a high-dimensional space. Then this SDE is effectively converting a complex distribution of images into a simple Gaussian one, containing only images filled with Gaussian noise. If we are able to reverse this equation, we can start from random noise and slowly move backward to the original distribution, the one containing our clean images. This means by reversing the SDE, we can generate brand new images starting from a Gaussian distribution. But can we even reverse this particular SDE? Luckily, yes, we can reverse this kind of Itô equation. Previous work from the 80s on stochastic differential equations tells us that under mild regularity conditions, any forward SDE has a corresponding reverse time SDE. This result was first formally derived by Anderson in 1982, and 40 years later it's now at the heart of diffusion models. Since the continuous version of the DDPM forward process is just a special case of an Itô equation, one that gradually pushes data toward a Gaussian, it means we should in principle be able to reverse it. And with this reverse SDE, we'll get back our original data distribution. So let's take a closer look at this reverse SDE. Let's first replace F and G with the DDPM coefficients to make this a little simpler. First, the diffusion coefficient stays the same. That's the easy part. But the drift term changes. We still keep the original drift from the forward process, but we need to subtract an additional term. We already know that beta t is our noise variance schedule. So the only thing we don't yet know is this new term, which we usually call a score function. I'll briefly go over what these functions represent in the context of diffusion models, but if you're not very familiar with this concept, I covered it in more detail in the videos on denoising autoencoders and the Langevin algorithm, so feel free to check those out for a deeper explanation. So let's say we have a distribution P of X. For the sake of illustrations, we'll take a simple mixture of Gaussian here. Some regions of the space have a high probability of containing samples. They're represented in purple here. The score of this distribution is a function that assigns to every point in space a vector pointing toward regions of higher probability. In other words, it tells us in which direction the density increases the fastest. You can also see it as a kind of compass, always pointing toward the regions of high probability. Now remember, in the forward process, we gradually corrupt the data with Gaussian noise, so our original distribution is evolving. At each time t, we denote by pt the distribution of the noisy samples, that is, our original data distribution, after being corrupted by the SDE up until time t. Okay, we already saw that the effect of this noising process on the distribution is to transform it slowly into a Gaussian centered on zero. Now what's the effect on the score function? Well, adding Gaussian noise to a distribution has sort of a smoothing effect on the distribution, which also smooths the score function. At the beginning, when the data is still clean, the score function is sharp and complex. But as we add more noise, it gradually flattens out, until, at the final time t, it becomes similar to the score of the normal distribution. To reverse the SDE and be able to generate new samples, we need to know the scores of these intermediate distributions pt for every time step, from pure noise back to clean data. Of course, we don't know their expressions, so now we'll see how we learn these scores using a neural network. First of all, let's talk about the architecture we typically use for diffusion models. The backbone is usually a UNet, a simple convolutional architecture that's become a staple in almost every task in image processing. It might also include attention layers or other more recent blocks, but it's still basically a U-shaped network that captures both local and global features. In the case of diffusion models, we slightly adapt the input. The network doesn't just take a noisy image, it also takes the time step t. Giving the time step as input tells the network how far along the forward diffusion process we are, which helps it know which score function it's supposed to output. Okay, but now how do we train this network? What we want is for the network to approximate the score function at every time t. Formally, we define a loss that measures how far our network's output is from this true score, and we take the expectation over random time steps t and data samples x0. So to predict the score, we need to know the score in the first place. Of course, in most cases, we don't know this score, otherwise we wouldn't be trying to learn it in the first place. Luckily, it's been known for a while that minimizing this kind of loss is equivalent to learning the score of this conditional distribution, p of xt knowing x0. I'll spare you the derivation here, but I'll include a link in the description for those who want to dig into the math. So what does this conditional score look like in practice? Well, for the SDE associated to DDPM, we know that this conditional distribution is actually a Gaussian, so computing its score is very easy. We just have to compute the derivative of a Gaussian. So let's write this score explicitly. We end up with this simple expression which only requires knowing x0, the ground truth, and xt, the noisy sample. And because xt is constructed from x0 and the Gaussian noise epsilon, we can write the conditional score depending only on epsilon. And that's it. When we plug this into the loss, we have a training objective that is very similar to the DDPM training loss. However, if we take a quick look at both losses at the same time, you can see that in one case there's a minus between the network's output and the noise, and in the other there's a plus. This is just because both networks learn two different things. In DDPM, the network learns to remove noise, while here the network learns the score of the corrupted data distribution. In fact, the way these networks are expressed make them approximately opposites, but both can be used to generate new samples. So let's see how we do that now that we have our score estimates. All right, so we have this beautiful SDE where we can now plug the neural network we previously trained to approximate the score functions. If we want to actually use this continuous time equation to generate samples, we need to discretize it. Now, there are many, many ways to discretize an SDE. It's an entire research field on its own. So for now, we'll stick with the simplest and most commonly used method, which is called the Euler-Maruyama discretization. Don't worry, this is just a fancy name for a very simple way of discretizing this equation. First, we approximate the infinitesimal change dx as the difference between x at the next time step and x at the current one. And after that, instead of taking an infinitesimal change in t, we take a discrete time step delta t. Finally, we also need to discretize the Brownian process. It's again very simple. It's just square root of our time increment times a sample from a normal distribution. And that's pretty much it. Now we have a very simple algorithm to generate samples using our trained neural network, which acts just as the one in DDPM. Let's wrap things up with a quick recap. In DDPM, we started by describing the noising process as a discrete Markov chain, which converges to a normal distribution after a lot of iterations. In contrast, the score-based formulation uses continuous stochastic differential equations to describe the same idea as a smooth evolution over time. To reverse the process, DDPM defines a reverse Markov chain where the neural network predicts the mean of a Gaussian at each step. In score-based diffusion, we rely on theoretical results from SDEs, which tell us that there exists a reverse time SDE that depends on the score function of the data distribution. Then, to train the network in DDPM, we use the evidence lower bound. After some algebra and simplifications, we saw that the elbow was similar to matching the approximate posterior to the true posterior, the one conditioned on the original image. In score-based models, the network is instead trained to approximate the score function using denoising score matching. In the end, in DDPM, we parameterize the network to output the amount of noise present in the image at each time step. And of course, in score diffusion, the network outputs the score function. Despite these differences, the final loss in both cases is very similar. It's just a weighted L2 loss against Gaussian noise. Now, with all that said, the score-based formulation is, in my opinion, much more general. With score-based diffusion, we're not limited to a single diffusion equation. We can choose many different SDEs to corrupt the data. DDPM turns out to be just one special case among many. We also have a lot more freedom in the implementation of each part of the process. We use the Euler-Maruyama solver for discretization, but many other numerical solvers are possible. And while denoising score matching works well to learn the score functions, it's also just one of several viable training objectives. This SDE formulation is also the basis for an even more recent generative model called flow matching, which I'll definitely cover later this year. Thank you so much for watching this short dive into score-based diffusion models. If you enjoyed the video, feel free to like and subscribe to support the channel. I'm not sure what the next video will cover just yet, but I'll see you then.